If you want to turn over to the book of Philippians, we talked a little bit about this morning in class about handling sufferings and tribulations, and so I decided to call an audible and move this afternoon's sermon to this morning and this morning's sermon to this afternoon. So we're going to do a little flip-flop here. Philippians chapter 1, let's read as we start off, starting in verse 3 of Philippians chapter 1. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, making request for you all with joy, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Just as it is right for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my chains and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you all are partakers with me of grace. For God is my witness how greatly I long for you all with the affection of Jesus Christ. And this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and all discernment, that you may approve the things that are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness which are by Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. You know, we think about Paul as he writes this section of Scripture, he writes this book. He is imprisoned in chains in Rome. You know, he could have spent the time that he was in chains in self-pity. He could have spent it complaining. I know if I was in prison and chained up, I probably would not have a lot of really good things to say. He could have done all of that. He could have acted in that way. But instead, he spent the time that he had in prison encouraging others. In fact, of chapter 4, verse 4 of the same book, he says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice." Going through all of these things, and he says, rejoice. You know, we may not be bound with chains. We may not be put in prison, but most of us have some type of chains of varying sizes and lengths. We have different things that encumber us. We have different things that weigh us down. You know, it might be a death in the family. It might be a death of a loved one that weighs us down. It might be failing health, or it might be medical problems that weigh us down. It could be something in our marriage or something with our children that's weighing us down. A lot of people, it's financial or it's job struggles. You know, whatever the case may be, we all have some kind of chains that weigh us down each and every day. How could an apostle or the apostle Paul be happy in his literal chains? How was he happy in everything that he did? And how can we be happy in our life with the chains that we have? And I want us to look at that this morning. The first thing that we do, the first way that we can be happy in the chains that encumber us, is that we look at the past with thanksgiving. We look at the past with thanksgiving, and we see that in verses 3 through 5, where he says, "I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, making request for you all with joy for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now." Paul was able to be happy in his chains because when he looked in the past, he was able to do so with thanksgiving. He had been associated with the congregation in Philippi. If you try to add up when he took his missionary journeys and when this time period is, this is probably about 10 years. He had fond memories of the congregation and the people. He could look back on that time. He could look back on this congregation and look back on it, in a good way. He says, "I thank my God upon every remembrance of you." All remembrances of you. is kind of a better translation there. I thank my God upon all remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, making requests for you all with joy. Paul looked for the good in things, and even though he was suffering mistreatment and he had suffered such bad things in Philippi, he still looked for the good in things. 1 Thessalonians 2 verse 2, he says, but even after we had suffered before and were spitefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we were bold in our God to speak to you the gospel of God in much conflict. You know, Paul wasn't treated very well in Philippi. If you go back and look at what happened, he didn't have a good experience. Remember, we hear about the Philippian jailer and, you know, Paul being in prison and what all transpires with that in the book of Acts. He could look back and see unpleasant events. But we see what Paul does when he looks back on those events. Romans 8, verse 28, he says, we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. You know, in Acts chapter 16, it talks about this time that he had in Philippi and being wrongfully imprisoned. But you see what he went through, and you see that wrongful imprisonment and the bad things. And then you read about the Philippian jailer and his entire household believing the gospel. You see people being spread because of this incident and the gospel being preached in other places. When Paul looked back on the situation, even though the situation was unpleasant, even though bad things happened during the time, Paul looks at the good that came from it. You know, are we a glass half full or a glass half empty kind of person? I'm a glass half empty kind of person. I really have to work to be positive with things. But when we go back and we look at the past events, even things that were not pleasant, even things that may have been bad or things that caused us a lot of grief, when we look at those things, we can look at them with what good comes from it. Did I grow spiritually because of what happened? Did people have a chance to help me out because of what happened? Therefore, being able to do their duty as a fellow Christian in helping me. You look at all of the things that can come from the bad situations, and that's what Paul did here. Paul's pleasant memories were focused on the Christians. We know that they faithfully supported his work in verse 5. He says, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. That word fellowship, the Greek word there, to have in common, it is that word that embraces the concept of sharing, of jointly participating in something. You know, this was a congregation that not only prayed for him and probably supported the work financially that we see in chapter 4, verses 15 and 16, but this was a congregation that it says was an active participant with Paul. So he looks back at the memories, the things of them serving together, the ways that they're supported. You know, what are things that we do together as Christians? Do we look back on those things? Do we look back and we see the good that comes from the time that we are together? You know, it is good for us to spend time together and to do activities that help to spread the gospel. You know, we're handing out candy tonight, and I know, you know, Halloween is one of those things that I don't really care for. You know, I don't care for the dead and the zombies and this and that and whatever else that's all gotten associated with Halloween. But as far as the community of Forestburg, tonight is a night where the kids walk through town and they provide a safe environment for the kids to walk up and down and get candy and have some activities. I think it's important for us as a congregation to be involved in those type of things. You know, we set up a table out here and let kids come and pick up candy. Why? It's important for us to be seen in the community. But when we are seen in the community, we're also doing things together. You know, I remember, what was it, a couple of years ago when we handed out candy, and then I think all of us got COVID the next week. No, I'm just kidding. Great memories. But do we have memories of doing things together for good? You know, I have some fond memories thinking back on that year of COVID with all of us getting sick. I have fond memories of us replacing this floor in here. We probably didn't do it real well, and a bunch of us got sick in the middle of it, and we had all kinds of fun things go on. But we have memories of spending the time with each other and helping each other do that. You know, we have memories of things that we do, and that should help us want to do more. You know, if we have good things in the past and we're spending time and we have those positive memories, don't we want to create more of those? And that's what Paul is looking at here. He's looking at the work that was done together. You know, we know they prayed for him, chapter 1 and verse 19. We know they support him financially, chapter 4 and verse 15 and 16. But they also were involved. Are you involved in the work of the church, or are you in your pew giving your money and saying, I'm doing my thing? Or are we involved? Paul was involved in this congregation, was involved with him. And that caused memories, and that helps you when you look back. You know, Paul could be happy in chains because he looked at the past with thanksgiving to God. You know, we can't concentrate on the bad things that happen in life. And we also can't just keep looking back at the good old days. But we can use those positive memories. We can use the things that we have done in the past to help strengthen us. You know, this congregation has done a lot of good work for many years. And you can sit, you know, we can sit here and we can look in the past and we can say, you know, I remember the day when we had X number of bodies in here and, you know, we participated in this and we did this. Or we can look at it as, you know, before we were this size and we did these things and we were involved in these ways. Why don't we do that again? That can help us. We thank God for the things that he did through the congregation in the past, and that causes us to then want to do more and to be better. So we look at the past, first of all, and we thank God for the things that he has given us. Secondly, we look at the present. We look at the present with confidence, and we have that confidence because of God. Verses 6 through 8 here, he says, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. Just as it is right for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my chains and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you all are partakers with me of grace. For God is my witness how greatly I long for you all with the affection of Jesus Christ. So Paul is thinking about the Christians in Philippi, and he's flooded with emotions here. And you see the love that he has for these people. It says he longs for them with all of his heart. Paul loved them with this love that characterized our Lord. And as Paul remembers his brothers and sisters in Christ, it says he is also filled with confidence. So he has love and he has affection, but he's also filled with confidence. Paul is happy in prison because he was able to look at the present with confidence in God. He wasn't self-confident, he was God-confident. You know, when you look at Philippians chapter 2 and verse 12, it says, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Paul is saying we work out our salvation. And he was happy because they were doing that, even though he wasn't there. They were doing what they needed to do. And the confidence is in God. The confidence is knowing that God is with us. The confidence is knowing that God is there for us, and that allows us to get through the things that we are going through. You know, Paul loved these people and he wanted them to be sufficient, to be able to do their own things, so to speak, to be able to get through the struggles that they had and to be able to make it through. And that gave Paul confidence to do what he needed to do. Do we look at each other and see the things that each other are doing? And does that give us confidence and hope to continue pressing through? You know, I look at certain members of this congregation and I see the struggles that they go through and the hardships that they go through, and I see the life that they live, and that gives me confidence to know that I can make it through the things I go through. Do you have a friend or a family member that you know of that has just gone through a lot of terrible things or really hard things, and they've kept strong and faithful, and that gives us the confidence? Knowing that God strengthened them and God will strengthen us. The confidence here expressed by Paul is because of who God is. His confidence was bolstered by the Philippian Christians because he sees the God-like qualities in them. He sees the work that they are doing. You know, God does not look for perfect people in whom to work. If God looked for perfect people, there wouldn't be any work for God to do, right? There wouldn't be any work for us to do if we were all perfect people and that's all we looked for. None of us are perfect. We all have struggles. We all have issues. We all have things that we've got to get better at. But if we look at people working and we see people trying their hardest and we see people trying to make it through everything going on around them, we can then make it. You know, we know that God works in our lives. We know that God helps us in our lives. And this isn't some miraculous thing. That is, this isn't the little voice in the back of our head telling us what to do. Although kind of is the little voice in the back of our head telling us what to do. Why and how? Through his word, first of all. You know, Hebrews 4 verse 12, for the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. God's word can get us through all of these things, but I've got to know it. And when I know God's word well enough, then I do hear that little voice in the back of my head saying, this isn't the right thing to do, or this isn't the right way to go, or this isn't the how you need to do this. Why? Because I've studied and I've learned enough that I know better. And that gives me confidence. Have you ever listened to something or heard something or hear somebody talk, and in the back of your mind you're going, boy, that really doesn't sound right. I've got that ability to be able to figure that out. That should give me confidence. God works in us through his word, but he also works in us through events in our lives. James chapter 1, verses 2 and 3, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces patience. You hear the old joke that people say, don't ever pray for patience? Because God will answer the prayer. But we need to be more patient, right? We need to be better Christians. And how do we become stronger Christians? By getting through trials. And we talked about in class this morning the sufferings and the trials that happen, and talking about the comfort that God gives us. And remember that comfort goes with trials and suffering. And when you see the word comfort, you see the words trials and suffering in close proximity to it. Why? They go hand in hand. Through trials, through sufferings, through temptations, we grow stronger, or we should. And we get through those things. God works through these events that happen in our lives. God also works through people. 2 Corinthians 7, verse 6, nevertheless, God, who comforts the downcast, comforted us by the coming of Titus. In this situation, Paul was comforted by Titus coming to them and being there for him. Have you ever been going through a time or going through something and you just happen to get that perfect phone call or that perfect text message from that individual, or somebody just happens to knock on your door that day? people work. You know, God works through people around us. People that can help us and inspire us. So when we look at going through the things of the current day, you know, we have to know that we have confidence because God is working through all of these things. God is working through His Word. God is working through other people. God is working through the events that are happening in our lives to help us be better. What qualities permit God to work in the lives of Christians? Well, verse 7, just as it is right for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my chains and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you are all partakers with me. Paul uses that Greek word again. This time it's translated as partaker, but it is the same Greek word we also that we already talked about. He mentions three things he and the brethren have in common. And he says, you didn't turn your back on me. We know from the way this is written, some people did when Paul was imprisoned. But these people did not. It says he says they defended, they confirmed the gospel when it was attacked. They gave a verbal defense. That word defense, the Greek word, means a verbal defense. And they taught and they exhorted. And then that helped build Paul up. You know, whatever our challenge is in life, we have to remember that if we are faithful children of God, we don't have to face those challenges alone. Paul here had confidence in his brethren. Paul had confidence in God. He knew that God would work through him, through the Word. He knew God would work through the people in his life. He knew God would work through the events in his life. And he had confidence to make it through. You know, Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 20. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think according to the power that works in us. How do I make it through the things that go on in this world? How do I make it through struggles? How do I make it through temptations? How do I make it through sufferings? I look to God's word that gives me comfort. I rely on my fellow Christians to help me get through it because I know that they will defend me, they will comfort me, they will help me in whatever way is possible. And then I know and I understand that God can help me through it and that I will learn from it and that I will grow from it and I will become better. I can look to the present with confidence in God. But then number three, we look to the future with prayer to God. So we've looked at the past, thanking God for the past that we've been given. We go through the present, looking at having confidence that's given to us by God. And now we look to the future in prayer to God. You know, regarding what was ahead, Paul did not ignore the realities of his life. He knew that he was going to face some challenges going forward, and he also knew the Philippians were going to face some challenges as well. So let's look at verse 9 through 11. And this I pray, that your love may abound still more and more in knowledge and all discernment, that you may approve the things that are excellent, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Paul prayed that they would grow in love. He prays, the way that word is written, is that love would abound from them. That they would always seek the best of one another. Do we abound in our love with each other? Does our love grow for each other? So much so that we seek the best for everyone. You know, do I look to myself first or do I look to others? You know, how cold do we want to get it in here?
I'll turn it way now. And I'm using it as a silly example. Sometimes we are not the most comfortable because we know others are comfortable, right? That's part of our love. But then it goes past something as silly as temperature, and you move to, how much do I truly care for each and every one of you, and what am I going to do about it? Do I see people that are hurting? Do I see some people going through things? Do I see people not here? And does my love that I have for them cause me to do something? Does it cause me to help in some way? We need to grow in love. Paul prayed also that they would grow in knowledge. This is spiritual knowledge. How do you grow in knowledge? You study. You study Scripture. How do we look to the future? By studying and growing and learning. He also prays that they would grow in their ability to discern between right and wrong. And this is understanding. This is more than just the knowledge. There are a whole lot of people in this world that are extremely book smart, but they don't have the ability to put two and two together and use it for anything. There's a lot of scholars out there that know a whole lot of Bible, but do not understand God's word. We need to be able to do both, which means we have to study and read God's word, but then we have to really dig in and learn God's word and be able to see what it truly wants us to do and how we are supposed to do things. We need to be able to discern right and wrong. When something comes up, I ought to be able to make that decision about whether that's right or whether it's wrong. Paul prays that they would grow in Christian character. He says, sincere and void of offense. Sincere, if you look at that that Greek word, it literally means it literally means to be judged by the sunlight. To be judged by the sunlight. So, you know, he's praying that they would grow in their Christian character. Grow to where they are a person that somebody looks at them and they see exactly what they get. We need to be those type of people. Paul also prays that they would grow in living fruitful lives. What does it mean to be fruitful and to live a fruitful life? It doesn't mean that it means more than just having good characteristics. It means there's more to it than that. There's something additional there. It means I work. I do something. I bear fruit. You know, you can have a beautiful tree. You can have a tree that blooms out and it looks absolutely gorgeous and doesn't produce any fruit. You know, I tell the story about us having an apple tree in the backyard of our house growing up. None of us knew it was an apple tree. It was a pretty tree. We thought it was nice. Looked great in the backyard. Well, then we got a goat from my grandfather. And that goat proceeded to prune every living thing in that backyard up as far as that goat could get up on his little back legs. He pruned every tree and every bush in that backyard, and you looked in our backyard, and for the height of that goat on his back legs, there were no leaves below that point. That next year, that tree started producing apples. All the years we had lived out there, we never knew it was an apple tree. Till that goat pruned it. You can have something that is supposed to produce some fruit that doesn't, and you don't know the difference. How do people know that we're Christians? By the fruit that we produce. We have to be doing something. There has to be something coming from our lives that people know we are who we say we are. He prays that they would grow in fruitful lives. To face the future with confidence, we have to live closer to God each day. We have to draw closer to Him each and every day. And one of the main ways we do that is through prayer. Yes, we've got to study. Yes, we've got to learn. Yes, we've got to use each other. But we have got to pray to God. Why? Because if we want to be more like Him,
How better to get there than to pray to him with the things that are on our heart and ask him for the guidance that we need? There's no better advice for those who are in chains than getting our eyes off of ourselves and putting them on God. Do we look to him for guidance? Do we look to him on what we need to do and how we need to live and how we need to act? We have to look to the future going forward, and we have to do it prayerfully. How do we react to the chains of life? When things are going on and things are happening, and you know, I guarantee life is going to throw things at us. Life is going to be difficult in a lot of ways. Do we sit and we look back at the good old days? We look at how things used to be. We long for those days. Or do we turn it around and we thank God for the wonderful memories we have and the wonderful things that we had in the past, and we figure out how we can do it again? Do we look to the present? I said it again. I'm getting my words ahead of the next words ahead of that one. Do we look to the present? Do we look to the present time and we get worried because we see all of the things going on around us, or we see the struggles that we have? Or do we look at the present and know that I have confidence because of what God gives me? Do I look to the future being worried about it or scared? Or do I pray to God and I look with excitement, and I look with the ability to grow? What this whole lesson boils down to is, who do we rely on? Do we rely on ourselves, or do we rely on God? Do I look to myself and I look at the things that I can do and how I can handle things, or do I look to God? Because through God, we can get through anything that is thrown at us. But if I rely on myself, I'm going to fail. We need to be a people that truly, like Paul here in the book of Philippians, we look to our Lord. We know that he will take care of us. We know that he will get us through. We know that he will allow us to make it through whatever challenges come our way. We pray to him earnestly. We rely on each other and rely on him. Let's be the people that God wants us to be. Are we the Christian that we need to be? Well, we can always get better. We can always learn. We can always grow. And we can always get better. But one thing we can do, if we're struggling, going through issues, we can pray for each other. And that's one thing that we are here to do, is pray with you and help you. If you have not been the Christian you need to be, if there's anything you need this morning, please come as we stand and sing.